Welcome, it's fantastic to see you. Are you all science students?
Yes.
Yes. So am I, I'm a science geek. My name's Sally Coburn, I'm a doctor. When I was at school, I wanted to do biology, chemistry and physics, and they said, nah, you can't. You're not allowed to do science and biology together. And I said, what do you mean? Biology's a science. Things have changed. What we like is to see everyone recognising science for what it's doing for the world. Science will change the world. Some of you may be those people. Any one of you could be the next person to invent something that's going to be absolutely wonderful. And you're going to be inspired. You will have teachers in your life who teach, and they do a good job. Then you'll have teachers in your life who inspire you. Hopefully you've already met someone. You're going to hear people speak who say some stuff. And then you're going to hear people that are going to inspire you. Today is going to be one of those days. You will remember today for the rest of your life because the speaker you're about to hear is changing the world. He's absolutely wonderful and I know he's inspired me and he's going to inspire you. I'm going to tell you a bit about him. His name is Donald Ingber. He's a director of Harvard's Wyss Institute for Biologically Inspired Engineering. Sounds like an oxymoron, biology and engineering. You'll hear more shortly. He's also the Judah Folkman Professor of Vascular Biology at Harvard Medical School and Boston's Children's Hospital. He's also Professor of Bioengineering at Harvard School of Engineering and Applied Sciences. He has presented over 455, well now it's six, international presentations. Now, he's had 380 publications and he has 86 patents for various incredible inventions. Ladies and gentlemen, this is a man who has spoken everywhere, has been advisors to NASA, to the Office of National Intelligence, National Security Agency and the US Congress, and now he's here to talk to you. He's going to be talking about some fantastic stuff, convergent science. What's that? He'll tell you more. Put your hands together for Donald Ingber.
Thank you, Sally, and thank you for all showing up. I know that's often a big challenge for all of us, and finding time to listen to what might seem like a strange world that I come from of America, Harvard University, biology, engineering, chemistry, physics, computer science all mixed together. But what I'm going to do today, right now, is tell you a bit about how I got where I am. And I think give you a feel for how science and how life works and that it's not a linear path. You sort of bounce around, but you follow your passions and then as a result, strange things happen. So you just heard about all my impressive affiliations. So if you read my bio sketch, you'll see that I'm a professor, an endowed chair professor at Harvard Medical School in pathology and at Children's Hospital in pathology and surgery. But I'm not a pathologist and I'm not a surgeon. And you'll see that I'm a professor of bioengineering at Harvard School of Engineering and Applied Sciences. And I'm the founding director of the Wyss Institute for Biologically Inspired Engineering at Harvard University. But I've never had an engineering course in my life. So how did I get here? So let me take you through a tale, what I call tales of discovery from a life without borders, because that's what it has been for me. This all starts when I was an undergraduate. I got to Yale and I was just 17 years old when I started as a freshman. And I did focus on science. I was majoring in science, but I always had a passion for art. Now, at any school in America, and probably here too, the science students went this way and the art students went that way and they never mixed. But one day I was walking around campus. I was working in molecular biology and on the molecular biophysics, how the shape of a molecule affects its function. So it's sort of, if you've ever learned about enzymes and substrates and they show pictures of a lock and key and how they fit together, and or DNA is a double helix, we were learning that the shape of things is all important. And one day I saw students walking around with sculptures. They were art students made out of cardboard that they cut with, they scored and then bent, that looked just like this. And it was really amazing to me because I had just learned about viruses that looked just like that. They looked exactly the same. And I asked these students, you know, where did you build that? Why did you build that? They said, well, I built it in a sculpture course. And I said, what's the name of the course? And they said, three-dimensional design. Well, three-dimensional design was what I was learning about in molecular biology, was the key to understanding how molecules impact function. So I took this course, and it's a long story about how I got into the course, but although I was able to meet the professor. They usually don't let scientists in art course, and he was an Austrian, very huge hands, sculptor, big glasses, a wooden leg. He lost in World War II, terrifying. And he said, "Why do you want to take my class?" And I basically said, "Well, I work on molecules and everything at the molecular level, three-dimensional design." And he said, "Tell me what you mean." And I said, "Well, DNA, it's the fact that it's a helix, that they fit together in space, and the nucleotides, that's where the information is." He said, "Hmm." And then I said, "Well," he said, "is that the only reason?" I said, "Well, muscle, there's molecules that they slide next to each other like screws, and as they screw, they get shorter, and that's how you get tension in muscle." And he said, "You're in." And then I said, "No, really, viruses, they're like geodesic domes." And he said, "You're in, just come Monday, just come to the course, leave me alone." And so I showed up on Monday, and the first thing we did is, this is where I learned about a building system that is called tensegrity architecture. It was first described by Buckminster Fuller, who makes these geodesic domes. You may have seen monkey bars like this, climbing things in the park. And there's a sculptor, Kenneth Nelson, who built them. Now, these are interesting. They use continuous tension for stability rather than man-made buildings. Man-made buildings use continuous compression. Think of brick upon brick type construction or Stonehenge. One stone on another, gravity pulls it, it's stable, hit it from the side, it falls like dominoes. These structures get their stability from continuous tension. And this is the first sculpture I built in my class, made out of wood sticks and string. The sticks don't touch, yet it pulls itself up from gravity. And so I'm going to show you here a sculpture that I built years ago. You see this little sculpture? It's made of black sticks that do not touch, and they're connected by red elastic strings. If I took the strings away, I'd just have a pile of sticks. If I took the sticks away, I basically have a continuous set of strings that would be like a spider web cut off of tree branches that have no shape stability. But because I connect them this way, the sticks push out the strings and put them under tension, and the strings compress the sticks, and it forms a balance. And when it's not anchored, it's round. But my professor, as he talked, he was talking and lecturing about this, and I hope you can see this. He had this sculpture on the table, and he would just squish it, and it would bounce up in the air. And or if you look at it another way, if you spread it out, it would flatten, and then it bounces up in the air. Now, this was amazing to me, because I had just that week, 3 days before, started research as an undergrad working in a cancer laboratory at the medical school, where I learned how to culture cells. These are cells on a dish. Cells, you plate them on a dish, they're round, they spread out and flatten. And when you want to move them from one dish to the other, you add a chemical that clips their anchors to the dish, and the cells spontaneously round and bounce off, just like that model. Now, most people, this is 1975 or 6, at that time thought cells are basically built like water balloons filled with molasses. They're just goopy cellular membranes with goop inside. But the first papers I had heard about had been published where people started to see structures in cells that were basically, I saw, as a molecular framework of sort of molecular scale ropes, cables, and struts. And so I basically began to think, I immediately thought, well, cells must be built this way. Isn't that really cool, seeing this in the sculpture class? I should say, I went back to the cancer lab, and we were doing experiments with a cancer drug, and the drug changed the shape of the cell. And I told the postdoc I was working with, the senior researcher, I said, oh, the tensegrity changed. And he said, the what? And I said, the tensegrity changed. He said, what's tensegrity? And I said, oh, I learned about it in art class, Buckminster Fuller, sculptors, Kenneth Nelson. He said, never say that again. And so I basically shut up, and I went to the library, and I sort of read about it. I also was taking courses in developmental biology, how the embryo forms. What I'm going to show you is a movie of a fish embryo. This is the yolk sac, like an egg, the yellow part. The egg was just divided into two here. And you're going to see this is over 24 hours. The way that it develops is first the egg divides into two, and then four, and then eight, and then 16, 32, 64, 128, 256, and so on. They get smaller and smaller and smaller. But then the cells start pulling on each other, and they physically sculpt all the different organs. You're going to see the spinal cord and the brain and the eye. It's an incredible amount of physical forces applying to these tissues. Now, 120 years ago, when people didn't have chemistry and genetics, they said these mechanical forces must be very important for development. But once genetics and chemistry came in, they sort of threw the baby out with the bathwater, and they said it's all chemicals and genes. But I started to think maybe that wasn't exactly right. Furthermore, when you take cells out of tissues in the body, in the tissues, they'll have specific shapes. They're pyramidal, shaped like a pyramid or a cube. Take them out, they round up, put them on a dish, they spread out. And if you put them on a flexible dish, you could actually see they really are applying tension. They're contracting it. And cells are not glued to substrates. They don't stick straight to a plastic. They put out what's called extracellular matrix. These are protein molecules, like collagens, that are what hold cells together in the tissues. They're produced by the cells. So the cell sits on it and spreads out on it by pulling. And it gets flatter and flatter as it pulls more and more. The anchoring sites resist the pull. So you could think of cells sitting on this like eggs in an egg carton. This is what is holding all the cells together in our tissues. So because of this, I started, and the last thing, in the same time period, about 2 years later, 1978, there was this paper in the journal Nature. Nature and Science are the two big journals that everybody reads. Discovery of new planets are there, discovery of new cancer drugs. And there was a paper by a scientist at Harvard named Judah Folkman that said cell shape, the shape of the cell, whether it's flat or round, may actually affect its growth. It wasn't conclusive, but it was very interesting, and it really made me think, if the shape is important, and if tension is controlling the shape, and tensegrity is controlling how tension regulates form, maybe there's something I need to learn more about. Now, I went on to Yale graduate school and medical school at the same time. In America, we can do an MD and a PhD at the same time. I actually did it because it paid my way. You actually get a scholarship if you can get into the programs. But I also went on to keep my options open because I thought medicine was interesting, but I really liked science. Now, I started to think about these ideas and think about how could this work during the development of tissues and organs. And what you have here is sort of, imagine it's like a cross-section of a tissue. This is like, think of a slice of bread through a loaf. So you're looking at it from the side. So the cells line up in many tissues like this. They form a layer of cells, and they sit on that egg carton called extracellular matrix here in green. And what one scientist had showed in the late 70s is that when you start with an embryonic, when you form an organ in the embryo, let's say the intestine is growing as a tube, and off of it's going to come something like the pancreas. It forms by a little bud coming on the side, and then that bud buds again, and it buds again, and it buds again. It forms a bunch of grapes, but it's lined by cells, and that's your organ. So this person showed that the way the bud forms, the first step is actually chemicals causing local breakdown of that egg carton, and it thins. And then that's where you see more growth. The cells in red grow more than the ones on either side. And there's also more matrix production. In fact, more for every 10 that are clipped out, 20 are put in. So it actually extends outward, and you get a bud. The cells double when there's twice the amount of matrix, and you get a bud. Looks like a little balloon coming out. Now, people were working on soluble factors, chemicals, hormones that control growth, but they're all over the place. So it didn't make sense for me. How could the cell here grow and bend outward, but the cell next to it not? But the tensegrity made me think that maybe it's mechanical, because why does it thin here? Well, it could be that there's less, it's being removed, but all the cells create tension because they have fibers in them, the cytoskeleton that acts like muscle. It's called actomyosin. The filaments shorten, they create tension. And as I showed you, that when you put them on a flexible dish, you could see it, they bring it up into wrinkles. But if it's a rigid dish, or a stable tissue, you can't see it because it's isometric. It's like a bow and a bowstring. There's tension in it. You know it, you pluck it, you can feel it, but you don't see movement. It's the same thing in these tissues. So the idea was, if this is a stable shape, then the cells are pulling, the egg carton is resisting, but the egg carton is itself flexible. So it's all in balance. So you could think of this egg carton more like a woman's stocking, stretched out. The cells are sitting on a stretched stocking. So the idea then was, if you thin that, you get a run in the stocking. That run stretches out more than the rest. That run would be, the red cells would be on the run. They'd stretch, the ones next to it would not. If it's true that spreading regulates growth, these cells would grow more than those, and you get bending. And so that is back basically an idea I suggested, that it's the stretching and the changes in tension that is guiding all this. Now, I also worked on cancer, and I was in med school, I was learning that cancer is not some foreign invader, like a you know pneumonia. It's your normal developmental tissues, normal processes going wrong. So instead of getting these simple bud and the bud budding again and it being very regular, they grow randomly and they pile up. As you see here in the video, they begin to grow and then they just pile and pile. And they grow without the boundary, without the egg carton growing. And so actually I suggested, but you still see thinning of the egg carton. So I suggested maybe changes in the matrix without increases in the egg carton could actually drive tumor formation. This everybody thought was absolutely nuts. This was 1981. And now people have confirmed this is actually part of the process of tumor formation. It's one way to cause tumor formation. And other things like viruses and chemicals that cause cancer can work through this process. Now, I tell you this because this led me to my next step in life, which is I was finishing my MD and PhD and I had to figure out where I'd want to work. And there's really only one person I could think of who I might work with. And Harvard had a program that allowed you to do both a residency, learn clinical medicine, and do research. But you needed a mentor, a Harvard faculty member. And Judah Folkman was the guy who showed that cell shape seemed to be linked to growth. But he also worked on cancer. And whereas most people work on cancer looking at what gene causes cancer, what mutation, he viewed it as a disease of, like I did, of development. He focused on cancers have to stimulate new blood vessels to grow into the tumor. And he thought, well, maybe because you need oxygen and nutrients to grow, any cell does. And without new blood vessels, the tumor would always remain very tiny. So he set out on a life path to try to develop inhibitors of the capillary growth that might inhibit cancer, which, by the way, is now one of the biggest selling drugs. That's how it works. So that brought me to Harvard, and I worked in his lab. But it also made me ask, once I got there, you know, is this true? Does physically stretching a cell control its function? And so I needed a way to actually control cell shape independently of chemical hormones and growth factors that are known to actually change cell shape, as well as adhesion to that egg carton, this extracellular matrix, because that's known to actually change gene expression and biochemistry. So the idea was, if I can make little adhesive islands coated with matrix that were the size of individual cells, then if I made a big island, like a big circular island, surrounded by non-adhesive areas, the cell would stick, pull, spread, flatten, and then it hits non-adhesive and it wouldn't resist and it would stop, and I'd get a pancake-shaped cell. If I made a smaller island, I'd get a cupcake-shaped cell. If I made a tiny island, I'd have a golf ball on a tee, and there'd be constant growth factors in the medium and constant density of the matrix on the bottom, so the only variable was stretch. Now, to do this, I had to come up with new techniques, because this is what science is all about. And so I reached out and started to apply using computer microchip manufacturing techniques. You know, why computer microchip manufacturing? Well, it's because it offers control over feature size at the same scale that living cells and tissues live at. You're talking about the nanometer to micrometer scale. So if you make little spots of matrix, and microchips are made by photolithography. That's what people who make, you know, art screening of T-shirts use. You basically use ultraviolet light and masks that obscure the light. And then you have a material that's sensitive to it, and some can be, once it's sensitive, it could polymerize or not, and the others wash away, and you're left with a pattern. And we could put matrix down in these patterns, and we could actually control cell shape. And just to give you an idea, nanometer scale, as you see here, 1 nanometer is to 1 meter or yard as the width of a blueberry is to the diameter of the Earth. So it's an incredibly small, small thing. So we're able to control this using microchip manufacturing. And I worked with George Whitesides, who had come up with a cheap way to make microchips for the computer industry by pouring a liquid material that would polymerize and make a soft silicon rubber that you could peel off. And when you take it off a substrate that had different maces in it, if you like, it would have the exact inverse shape. And you could use it as a rubber stamp, like you use ink stamps. And we could stamp those egg carton materials, the matrix, onto a substrate and put cells on it. And what we saw is that, just as we hoped, if you make a round, big pancake cell and a small egg, a golf ball on a tee, the big cell grows and the small cell actually, in this case, undergoes a death program, a suicide program that says die. And if you maintain the cells in the in-between stage, and we did this with those capillary blood vessel cells that are involved in tumor angiogenesis, if you hold them in the in-between stage and you let them form cell-cell contacts, those same cells form hollow capillary blood vessels in a dish with it lumened in the center, whereas right next to them where they're flat, they grow as a layer like any other cell. And you could actually, the cells literally take the shape to fit their container. If you make a square island, they have 90 degree corners. And that's because as it pulls until it resists, and then it stops. And now if you give it something that stimulates movement, cells move by putting out little exploratory fingers that are filled with these cytoskeletal proteins. And you see on a square cell, they come out of the corners where the cells are stretched the most, whereas in a round cell, there's no preference. Now, this led to another serendipitous experience, which is I'm working on cell shape, I'm working on angiogenesis, I'm working with capillary blood vessel cells, and one day I had a fungus contaminate my culture dish. Fungus is a bad thing in the lab. It's a bad thing for people. Sometimes you can get sick. But usually when you have this in a culture dish, all the cells pop off the dish and die. But what I found is that it was a big fungus, and you could see the little stringy things, but the cells beneath, and this is the same area at higher mag, right beneath it they were round, and then they were a little more spread, and then they were normally spread here. So I had a gradient of rounding. I just told you I was finding that the shape regulates growth, and I thought maybe this is secreting an inhibitor of the growth of these capillary blood vessel cells. So maybe it would inhibit angiogenesis, inhibit cancer. And that actually turned out to be the case. We could show it. We work with a chemical company. They made synthetic analogs. This actually went to clinical trials. The first cure in a human was published in New England Journal of Medicine. It's a very, very famous journal. Unfortunately, there was some both political issues, some corporate issues financially with the company, and there was a little bit of neurotoxicity, so it was pulled from the trials. Oops. But that is an example of both the power of science and also the frustration of science. Now, all this stuff on cell shape was that somehow cells stretching affects form, function of cells. But at the same time, people were realizing that all living tissues and organs are regulated by mechanical forces. You probably know that if an astronaut goes into space, their bone and muscles start breaking down. That's because they don't have forces on it. If you have an old person who is put in bed rest for 6 months, it's exactly the same as being in outer space. It's the fact that they're not moving and not having force. This is true. The blood pressure regulates the blood vessel wall, and it's true in basically every system in the body. So no one knew how cells can sense force. I was funded by NASA because people want to know how you sense gravity. And so I realized that the tensegrity model suggested how this would be. Before the tensegrity model, when people thought of a balloon filled with molasses as the cell, there was no way to get specificity. Wherever you push it, you kind of squish it, maybe you get a local effect, but there's no way to kind of affect the nucleus and get specificity. The tensegrity model suggested that forces are specifically transmitted where the cell anchors to the egg carton, where the scaffold of the cell anchors to the scaffold of the tissue, whereas if you just push on the membrane, it's sort of flexible and energy would dissipate. So to test this, we had to develop new techniques. And this involved mechanics, even though it was biology, involved mechanics and physicality. So I had to actually reach out and work with engineers and learn from engineers. And that's how I got into engineering. So I wanted to be able to show that forces go over these anchors to the matrix, to the cytoskeleton. I wanted to be able to pull on one receptor, one molecule on a cell versus another. And we did this by developing a technique where we took small magnetic beads. And this is one cell viewed from the side, and that's one magnetic bead. It's 4 micrometers in diameter. That's a millionth of a meter, millionth of a yard. We coat it with ligands that are from the egg carton materials and that bind these receptors. And now we could pull with magnetic forces and we can measure the response. And what this shows you at the bottom, I'll verbalize it, is that if you pull on a receptor, a molecule that goes to the membrane, but not where it anchors to the egg carton, it's very flexible. You pull on it where it's bound to the matrix, it's very stiff. You're actually pulling through the whole skeleton of the cell. It's like this. If I pull on the membrane in between, nothing, but if I pull here, I feel the entire structure. And I could use drugs to knock out the filaments and show that it was exactly like predicted by the 10-integrity model. In fact, we also showed that the cell responds physically in a very particular way. It gets stiffer and stiffer as you apply more stress, and that's exactly what the 10-integrity model has done. And with collaborating engineers, we developed a mathematical model of 10-integrity that now has led to many predictions that have been confirmed in many types of cells. Now, that still didn't convince people. I wanted to show that the cell is really built like this, that it has tense strings and compressed struts. So to do that, I reached out with an optical physicist who works on lasers. And what I wanted to do was to be able to cut one fiber in a cell at the nanometer scale. And we did this by developing what's called a femtosecond laser. I describe it in one interview as a James Bond laser, but on a very small scale. You create the heat of the sun, but for an incredibly short time, a millionth of a billionth of a second, and you focus it through a lens on a microscope so that 300 nanometer cube, you vaporize, you break things down to atoms, but nothing above, nothing below. And so what you see here is if we cut one of the, what are called stress fiber, the contractile fibers made of actin and myosin, with a laser right there, it pulls back. And this is a movie shown at the right of what happens. You see it pulling back. It's like if you cut a muscle at surgery, it does exactly the same thing. And we also could show that there are struts in cells. They're called microtubules. They're hollow. Normally, they're if you take them out of the cell, they're straight for 2 millimeters. But in cells, they're curved with 2 micrometers. And this is making them fluorescent using a protein called GFP, green fluorescent protein. It comes from a fluorescent algae, if you ever see them in the water. They take that gene and they put it in a cell, and you can make anything visible under light, fluorescent light. And this is a heart cell in a dish that beat. And now you can see when it contracts, they buckle, they curve. But when it relaxes, they spring back, showing that it's actually under compression. And cells are very much built like tensegrities or a tent. Think of a tent. You have a flexible membrane. You want to stabilize it. You put struts up. You put 10 pegs in the ground. You winch it in under tension. That's a tensegrity. So cells are not evenly glued. They're spot welded in these structures that are like 10 pegs, which we call focal adhesions. They're these little green spots at the end of each one of these actomyosin filaments, like a suspension bridge, pulling those things together. That's why when it's flexible, the substrate curves up in between. So now, when I was a grad student in my PhD dissertation, I realized that this simple model doesn't have a nucleus. So I wanted to build one with a nucleus. So I don't know if any of you have ever done chemistry, but in chemistry labs, they have aluminum bars that make a grid, and then you put clamps, and that holds your glassware. Maybe you'll see this when you get later on. I stole those, don't tell anybody, from the lab. I cut them into bars this high. I got shock cord from a sailboat, bungee cord, and I made a big structure just like this, but this high. And then we made a nucleus out of sticks and strings, and then I put black string to connect the nucleus to the cell surface, and I took pictures on a big sheet of black material in my living room. And when I attached it to a wood underneath and spread it, it looked like this, but when I detached it, it rounded up and looked like that. And later on, we showed this is exactly what cells do. And many people have shown this, all different cells. The nucleus spreads in a coordinated manner. So people couldn't believe that this would be true, that cells are hardwired, because they really thought they're like water balloons filled with molasses. So to show this is true, we took a glass rod, very small. We coated it with that egg carton material. We bound it to the cell so it formed an anchor to the skeleton, and we pulled really quickly. And what you see here is a microscope view of a cell. The cell actually goes off screen, but there's a round, lighter oval. That's the nucleus. And there are 3 little dots in there, dark, that are called nucleoli. These are structures in the middle of the nucleus of a living cell. We put the pipette about here, and then we pull down quickly. Boom, that's it there. And you see the nucleus becomes vertical. At the right is the same cell with a different optics. We actually use polarized optics in sunglasses. This is polarized optics. So it shows you molecular alignment. If it's vertical, it's white. If it's horizontal, it's black. When we pull down, those nucleoli become white, which means we're inducing molecular realignment by pulling on the surface anchoring molecules and going through the cytoskeleton all the way to the center. And we showed that this third filament system called intermediate filaments, which are known to go through the cell to the nucleus, actually mediate that. Now, seeing those structures inside the nucleus move means that there must be some coupling inside the nucleus. So we did what we call the Captain Ahab experiment. We took a pipette and we harpooned one chromosome in a dividing human cell in a dish. You can see we pull it out and you see the entire human genome, all the chromosomes attached. This is really nanosurgery, okay? And the cell is still alive, actually. And we actually can induce those chromosomes to unwind and rewind, and they all go back to the same shape and position. So there's enormous structure inside the nucleus, not only in the cytoplasm. And it's under tension as well. At a smaller size scale, people have already shown Kluge won the Nobel Prize for showing that all viruses are geodesic tensegrity structures. That was 1970s. And I suggested at even smaller scale that molecules you could think of like tensor. This is one of the sculptures I built in my sculpture class I took a picture of. This is a diagram of a molecule from the cover of the journal Nature that people published a few years ago. They're absolutely identical. Now, molecules have stiffened regions that are helices. They're very stiff. And then they have a flexible hinge, and then they have another helix, and then a flexible region. And then they're forces of attraction inside the molecule that are like tension elements, are pulling. And that gives the molecule its shape. If you disconnect if you get rid of those forces, it basically splays open like this, and it loses its stability. And I also showed you could build tensegrities all out of springs. You don't have to actually have sticks. It's much more like molecules. And then just 2 years ago, people actually, I won't read it, but they actually did experiments to confirm that molecules are, in fact, tensegrity structures. So to pull this together, what I'm saying is that artists have shown for years that our bodies are tensegrities, right? If you see a skeleton in an anatomy lab, they have to wire it together and hang it from a stick to look like us. But in reality, we're 206 bones, compression-resistant bones that are pulled up against the force of gravity and stabilized by a continuous series of tensile muscles, tendons, and ligaments. And if my arm is tense, if there's tone or tension, it's stiff. But if there's no tension, it's flexible. That's exactly how tensegrity works. So what I'm suggesting then is that nature uses this at all size scales. And that's how when I stretch my arm, my skin stretches, the connective tissue stretch, the cells, the nucleus, and nothing breaks. And also forces channel down, and force at a big scale, like gravity, would affect things inside the cell. And this is important because the cytoskeleton is more than a structural scaffold. It also orients most of the cell's chemical machinery, things like DNA replication and protein synthesis. And I won't go into this, but the idea was if you apply a force at the macro scale, it would channel down those filaments until you actually deform molecules. And what I had learned in my undergrad class on molecular biophysics is if you change the shape of a molecule, you change its activity. And again, the tensegrity model would then predict that if you pull on receptors that transmit force across the cell, you should see change in chemistry and gene expression inside. And we have, in fact, confirmed that's true. There's one experiment. We pull with these beads on the matrix receptors. And on the right, we're measuring calcium flowing into the cell through a ion channel, the little solar flares, and that's converting mechanics into chemistry. And calcium then can control contractility in a muscle cell, nerve impulses in nerve cells, and so on. So to end, what I basically discovered in my career is that mechanical forces are as important as chemicals and genes for biological control. I will tell you that when I was young, I was literally screamed at, even cursed at in meetings, because people said, that went out 100 years ago, everyone knows that's wrong. Now it's a major, major area in biology. The experience I had by exploring different techniques with microchip manufacturing actually led to what I'm going to talk about a lot today, which are called human organs on chips, because we use microchip manufacturing, and we're using these to replace animal models, so maybe someday you don't have to use animal testing for drug development or cosmetics or chemicals. The tensegrity is something that I published. If you have interest in the tensegrity story, I invite you to find an old paper in the library, 1998 Scientific American cover, which was called The Architecture of Life, where I basically described how this building system governs how living systems develop from the atomic scale to our body scale. And then finally, I invite you to the Wyss Institute website. You'll hear more about the Wyss Institute tonight that I think will excite you. We won the Webby a couple of years ago. That's the Academy Award of the Internet for the best science website. We beat out Wired Magazine and NASA Space Propulsion Lab. It has incredible movies and videos and games, and I think you'll enjoy it. And with that, I will end. Thank you so much.
Cells aren't squishy, because I think I always was taught that cells were squishy, and I think that comes from breaking an egg. You know, you see this egg and it comes out.
I have an old slide from a 1940s textbook that basically had a picture of an egg, of a soft-boiled egg and a hard-boiled egg, as plant cells and animal cells. So, yes.
So I wonder if anyone's got any questions. And
when you showed the capillaries growing and stretching and attaching to the tumor to supply them with the nutrients, you talked about the drug that can slow that down. Is that a preventative drug, or is it something you take after the tumor is formed in a...
It's something you take after the tumor. The tumor is continually growing, right? So if you can keep tumors 1 millimeter in diameter, you would never know you had them, right? So especially metastases, when tumors spread to distant sites like the lung. But it turns out that tumors are continuously growing, and if you restrict the blood vessels, you can actually shrink them or keep them steady, and then you can combine them with other drugs or other types of therapy. But it's also the best drug for blindness. There are people who could not drive, they were legally blind, and now they can drive again. Because blindness, of certain types of blindness, have too much blood vessel growth, and these drugs prevent that blood vessel growth. The same exact drug, sold under two different names, is used for cancer and blindness.
What drug is getting to this field of science?
I mean, it was exactly the path, right? I was interested, you know, in undergraduate college in America, it's called liberal arts. We do a little of everything. So although I was in biology, I took courses in history and English, and you know, I got into art classes, and I was surrounded by other students who did everything. So I never thought about boundaries between disciplines. And then I stayed at Yale and as a grad student and med student, and knew every library. I was familiar with every library. So it was exactly what I said. I wasn't sure I wanted to do science, but I actually, I was telling this story to an interviewer today. I was a major in science because I had a lot of advanced placement from high school, so that was easy. And I had a major that let me do all this other stuff, other types of classes. But I learned there was a fellowship to go to England that they would pay your way to Europe, to go anywhere in the world for the summer. But you had to have a mentor and a project. And I didn't speak a foreign language well, so I thought I'd go to England. And I had advisors who were scientists, so I thought maybe I'd do research and explore what it's like. I'd never done any lab research. So I talked to one faculty member. He told me the lab that I found, and I got a letter from, that it was a great place to go, but he said, why not work for me for this semester before you leave? And I did that, and I hated it. And I actually said, at least I know I never want to be a scientist. I'm going to go to medical school. But then I won the fellowship. I went to England. I had a great time because I worked with people who were a lot of fun. We're the first group of people. There was no one else in the lab but me. I was alone in the middle of nowhere. The other one, it was a very social environment. And I realized that, you know, I liked the people around me, and they were creative, and we had fun, and we were discovering things that no one ever knew. So that got me into science. That brought me back to Boston, got me to try to go to get into a cancer research lab. And then I always was intrigued by art. Pure serendipity, I got into this art class, and boom, that's what led me on this path.
Donna, it seems one of the things that comes through loud and clear is your inquisitiveness. And what worries me about sometimes students who start off as inquisitive start to get bogged down in that, oh, I've got to pass this exam. How do you keep that thirst for knowledge going?
Oh, I think that is the essence of success, because if you're just focused on the near term, it's like driving and looking at your knees, because all the interesting stuff is ahead. And I it's like walking and not noticing all the things around you. You just miss out on the richness of life. So I think that's a really good point. And I think people think that science is memorization, but if you can memorize it, it's not science, because science is describing the unknown. It's not scientists to a practicing scientist. It's past science, right? And therefore, if you're just focused on memorizing or learning what exists, that's not really the excitement of being a scientist. Judah Folkman was interviewed on television. He said, there's nothing more exciting than knowing that you have just discovered something that no one else in the world knows. For that instant in time, tomorrow morning everybody will know, but that morning you've just seen, and I felt with integrity that I saw, boom, and I felt like I touched the heartstrings of the universe, that I could see everything come together, and I could see, boom, everything that was the rest of my life. And basically I just had to confirm it. People said, where does this come from? It was obvious because I had this novel connections. It's always connections. So the more you look out, the more dots you could pull together.
But just before we move on to yours, I just wanted to also add to that, that you mentioned during your talk that you said something to one of your lecturers or teachers, yes, and they laughed at you.
Yes.
For most of us, that had put us off. Because, oh, maybe I'm stupid. That's the immediately thing. You obviously thought, no, you're stupid. I'm the one who knows.
Exactly.
How do you have that confidence?
You know, and this is a very big thing for scientists because you're continuously criticized. Every paper you publish, you submit, gets turned down. It almost always gets turned down first. Every grant gets turned down. You listen to your critics that are, and you listen to them, the smart ones, and you try to think, you know, why don't they see what I see? And oftentimes this led to my biggest breakthrough papers because I figure, okay, you know, some of the stuff is stupid because I see everything else and it doesn't match with what I see in the world, whereas mine can predict things theirs can't. But the ones that are tough lead me to think, how can I design an experiment that will convince them? And those were my science and nature papers, which I've had scores of. I tell my students, it's like, it's sort of academic jujitsu. Instead of getting hurt, you take that force and you flip it back and you throw them to the ground, but you do it intellectually.
We often hear about the relationship between science and mathematics, and often the assumption for a lot of students is that, you know, my maths is, you know, but so that therefore sort of puts science out of question. But it sounds to me like that you drew inspiration from art.
That's right. So I actually I graduated from high school with being the math award winner, and I competed in math, and I was naturally intuitively strong in math, but I got into the most sophisticated math course as a freshman. It was filled with students with big thick glasses who looked really nerdy. I turned around and never went back, but I can communicate with engineers and mathematicians and have a feel for what they're talking about, but I can't do it. In some ways, it frustrates me. That said, no, you do need math to do, you know, calculate solutions and other things, but that's not where necessarily the inspiration comes, but it is a use, you have to have a basic level, but you don't have to, not everyone does everything. Nowadays, you have to collaborate, so you have to collaborate with someone who's good at math. But you do have to have a basic level of math to get through the early years of, you know, just doing experiments and to do things robustly, reproducibly. But yes, in that way, I was inspired by it all. I just had to figure out, I was so focused on proving these people who thought I was an idiot wrong that I basically tried to figure out creatively, what can I do to show them that I'm right? And that's the driving force in science for a lot of people.
There'll be many students sitting here today who've probably been told, look, if you're going down a science path, not an arts path, so get rid of that violin, get rid of that fact that you play, you know, bass guitar in a band, that's irrelevant, is it?
I think if it's something that brings you pleasure, don't listen to anyone. If you're doing it because your parents told you to do it, that'll get you into school, get rid of it fast. But don't tell your parents I said that. And my son's here, so he knows that I hold by that, yes. Yes.
If cancer cells are affected by the matrix in which they grow,
yes,
could you manipulate that matrix and affect the growth of cancer?
Very good. And I just had a paper. So it turns out that if you take certain cancers and you mix it with the embryonic tissues that induce the matrix turn, you know, remodeling, clipping, and adding I was describing during normal tissue formation, you could actually make certain cancers become more normal. And we just isolated molecules from the matrix, from the embryonic tissues, and we can inject those tumors, and they look like they have an effect. And so, and then there are people actually trying to affect the mechanics of the matrix in cancers, because we have shown that if it's very stiff, the tumors grow faster and worse, and if you could change the stiffness, you could also slow the growth. You hear about stem cells a lot, probably in the press. These are cells that can become different types of cells. And there are things called mesenchymal stem cells. And people have taken these cells, and they're known that they could form different tissue types. If you put them on a matrix, an egg carton type material, that is the stiffness of bone versus the stiffness of muscle versus the stiffness of brain, so goopy, a little harder, very hard. You take these stem cells, put them on there with the same chemistry. They become bone cells on the bony, hardy one. They become muscle cells on the middle one, and they become neurons on the brain-like one, the goopy one. So the physics is actually so, so important.
So they're influenced by the rigidity of whatever.
They are controlled by the rigidity, and that's been shown by many, many, many groups. Yeah. Yes.
So I guess that leads into the idea that what was in the set, the form influences function.
Yeah. Structure dictates function. You know, not the other way around.
Does that mean that potential future research in this area could go into things like growing new organs for people?
Or yes. Yes, yes, and I formed one of the first tissue engineering companies in the late 80s, and that went into humans as artificial skins, and mechanics is absolutely critical. People stretching the skin, they stretch blood vessels to make them thicker and stronger, and so the mechanics is now a key part of organ engineering, tissue and organ engineering. I just had a paper recently where we studied how the tooth forms, because it's the simplest model of an organ. That layer of cells that bud, that I showed the first bud, then buds in, and you have roots. That's it. And then blood vessels and nerves come in. And I won't go through the details, but it's triggered by cells just beneath the upper layer condensing. It's called mesenchymal condensation. The cells, they're all over, and then boom, they get tightly packed. It's like and we found that how that's controlled is there are two factors that the overlying cells put out. One would be saying, everyone all the way to the back of the room, come towards the stage, and the other would say, move away from the stage, and everybody gets squished. And people in the field have looked at all the genes and chemicals that mediate this over the years. They say this goes up, this goes down, this goes up, but nobody understands how it works. So we found that some of those factors are the two things that induce these cells to get squished. But we found if you artificially squish the cells, you can induce tooth formation. And now we've made polymers, synthetic materials, like rubbery materials, but that can go in your body, that are like shrink wrap. You know how shrink wrap, you heat it and it shrinks? But they're like a sponge, and we put the cells in it, and when we put it to body temperature, they get packed like this condensed thing, and they form tooth materials. So we're beginning to use mechanics in engineering in many interesting ways. Oh, another one.
Yeah, it's one more.
Double play.
It's sort of like growing up. A lot of these students are growing up with movies like Spider-Man and Captain America and stuff like that. Do you reckon
Well, I'm not going to show this tonight, but we have a major effort funded by the military of the United States for flexible exoskeletons that can allow you to you get more energy. You're able to carry heavy loads without expending any extra energy, and you can actually go up faster, up and down mountains and run and things like that. Now, people have done these with big metal Terminator 4 robot things like this. These are going to be like fabrics. And we're making major headway on that. So it is Spider-Man-like. Yes.
Do they have sticky bits on the end so that they can climb the walls?
They've already done that. They have artificial gecko. We didn't do this, but other people have artificial gecko adhesives. And you could just, I've seen people use it. You could just put it on glass and you could pick yourself up on it. And then you just turn it another way and it comes off. Yeah, so.
Well, we know that, like, was it 30 years ago the internet was a military thing? So what they're doing.
It's the same group that funds us funded the internet. We used to call it the DARPANET, and DARPA is what funds us.
Wow.
Yeah.
Yes, question.
What you said before, how that, when you can squish it.
Yes.
You said if, you squish, the stuff in your body, you can, move your skin as well.
So what I'm saying is when I stretch, my skin stretches, and so has anyone ever had a brother or sister born in the room, right? Your mother gets pregnant, right? Mother's belly gets bigger, right? Her skin actually grows, and the way it grows is just a physical expansion, and so when you pull on the skin, that everything I showed, the forces go through that matrix to the cells. To these molecules that then change their activity that make them, the cells are stretching, so now they're two cells, and the skin gets bigger. So that actually does happen in all our tissues.
I'm sure from a cosmetic perspective, the next logical thing from a female perspective is, can you get rid of stretch marks?
So I was a consultant for Chanel Cosmetics. They used this, as an advertisement for their anti-aging cream, but it was white and black. All over the world, in every airport, Chanel. Because the tension in skin is absolutely critical for aging, and so, Yes?
Your inspirations come from the art world and into the science. Have you found anyone's been picking up your ideas to move into architecture or other?
Oh, these are used in architecture all the time. Some of the big stadiums are tensegrities, and they use it for protecting against earthquake resistance. There are artists who are affected by my work. I've had my images of cells and movies in museums, a museum of textiles, and the whole exhibit was called The Architecture of Life. I've been in, I've spoken in the Royal Institute of Architecture. There is a theater group in LA, UCLA, that does tensegrity-based performances where it's bizarre, but the people like wearing membranes and things. Yeah, so no, it's gone both ways.
If it's 1 minute, we can do it. What's your question?
You talk about changing form in terms of stretching and compressing. What about twisting it, like rotating the cells?
So, I mean, we actually did torque or shear or twist when we put our beads on it in our first paper. But it basically is transmitted through the same system through these forces. You actually don't have torque at individual joints in these structures, so it's kind of an interesting, complex question. But cells feel drag force on their surface, like the blood vessel cells feel the drag on their surface, and that regulates their function. And you know, if you eat too much fats, you get plaques, fatty plaques in your blood vessels. You only get them where the flow is disturbed, where it's smooth and linear and dragging on the surface, the cells are protected. So in theory, people are trying to say, well, if we could figure out what's different when cells are turbulent and smooth, we could protect us against having, you know, our blood vessels, you know, obstructed. And I will show you very briefly next talk, we now have therapeutics that target drugs to blood clots in vessels for heart attack and stroke and pulmonary embolism, because when you have a clot and it narrows the vessel, it makes the drag force go up, the shear. It's like putting your finger on a hose and it gets much higher. And platelets normally go to the blood clot or a narrowing of a vessel like a fatty streak or fatty plaque, and that's what gives you a heart attack. So we tried to mimic how the platelet targets by the high forces. And we made a little ball of nanoparticles that are approved for injection by the FDA. That's like, I described, like a wet ball of sand. You shape sand, it's round. If you shear it in your hands, it falls to grains. These are tuned, they only fall to grains if you have a narrowing of a blood vessel. And we could deliver very low dose of clot-busting drug to those sites and save animal lives. And 1/100th of the dose. And these are drugs used in humans, but only a small percent of patients are eligible because they can get bleeding in the brain and other places because they have to give so much. So we're now using mechanics for therapeutics too.
Amazing. Ladies and gentlemen, please put your hands together for Dr.
Thank you.
And I hope that you go back to your schools and stay with your studies and know that there is a fantastic future out there. And who knows, you may be up here one day doing the Graeme Clark Oration. And I just wanted to tell you a little bit about why we're here today. And Don has come over from America to be part of the Graeme Clark Oration. And I'm hoping you all know who Graeme Clark is, because what worries me about Australia is you probably know who Kylie Minogue is, you probably know who, you know, Greg Chappell is, who are, you know, various footballers, but Graeme Clark is probably one of our most amazing national treasures. He will be present tonight. Graeme invented the cochlear implant. You've probably got people at your school who have a cochlear implant. They're the people who were maybe born deaf and have been able to have an electronic instrument placed in their head and are able to hear. What an amazing thing. 320,000 people around the world. It was a Melbourne invention. We have got some fantastic science history here. And today, the ICT for Life Sciences Forum is responsible for bringing this all together. They're a group of people who've got together who believe that science is not just about science. It's about engineering. It's about art. It's about communications. We want you to go forth and make sure that you take that message that science is about life and you hold the future in your hands, and we're very proud that you are the next generation of people who are going to take science forward. So thank you so much for coming. It's been absolutely wonderful, and go forth and love your science. Thanks very much.